play. What's up? Yeah. Yeah.
Kane is in the building.
Yeah.
Alright, already the show goes on all night. Till the morning we dream so long. Anybody ever wonder when they will see the sun? Just remember when you come up, the show goes on all night.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Gentlemen's Club. And it is about to get so real right now because I have Darth Arma with me. Okay. Welcome to the show, Darth Arma.
Thank you so much for that godlike introduction.
It had to be good, man. I'm stoked to have you on.
Awesome. I'm so glad to be on.
All right, so I'll get started right with the questions here. So when did you start gaming competitively?
I could give you like a long story or a short story. I guess since we just started, I'll go ahead and give you the long story. I guess my first competitive game where I would actually go out and compete would be Halo 2. And this was just a bunch of locals when the game first came out. I remember getting bodied at like the first local I ever went to. This was before I even got Xbox Live. Like it was like 2 weeks after Halo 2 came out. And it was just so that feeling of knowing where you fall was just so devastating. But I just couldn't, like, how bad you were compared to people who played a lot.
The realization.
Yeah, and it just, it was very, I remember how discouraging it was and how I didn't want to play after. And that's why I always feel for, you know, these new guys who come out to the events. And that's why I always want to go out of my way to introduce myself or even play with newer players, because I know that feeling. I know it's not easy to get back out on a horse once it tosses you off its back, but it's definitely worth it if this is something you love. And I stuck with Halo, and I went back to that tournament's local. They had like a tournament every 2 months, and I actually started winning a lot because I kept practicing. And ever since then, I've just always had this thing where I wanted to play games competitively. And if we moved on to the fighting game genre, the first fighter I ever played, or the first fighter I played competitively, was Street Fighter 4. So I am your typical Capcom player, 09er, because that's how I got into it. I got into it right when a lot of people did.
Damn, you're the enemy in disguise, man.
I guess. I'm assuming an 09er is better than a brand new MK9 player. I'm not sure.
I don't know if there's a tier list out there, but if there is, I'm sure TYM has probably made one.
I mean, like, the whole I guess since Street Fighter is still riddled with so many OGs, that I guess that's where the term 09er comes from. From all these new people that came on when Street Fighter 4 came out. But I feel like I don't, as much as people talk about the negativity in the NRS community, that isn't something that I hear. I don't really hear people shitting on other people because of when they started playing a game.
Yeah, that's actually pretty true. There's, you know, when you're in our community, you're kind of in our community, and there's a lot of people that have just kind of been added over the years, because I've been part of the NRS community since about 2004, and there's people that have just kind of been added in that I just don't even really notice over the years. They're just there.
Yeah, but, I mean, I can't even – I feel like a majority of these great players, like, started with MK9. I mean, maybe you know a little bit more about it than I do. Maybe I just don't know about – players' past histories, but I guess I kind of like that.
It was definitely a good start. Like, MK9 certainly kickstarted, as far as there was like a couple of the OGs from back in the day, like Pig of the Hut and Lord of the Fly, but the majority, like Perfect Legend, 16-bit, Chris G, all these guys that are really top players and have really performed well, got their start and their fame from MK9.
You know, people are going to be a little upset that you called them I feel like people might think they're OGs when or we might not know when someone's an OG. Like, I absolutely have no idea. When you said right now Pig of the Hut and Lord of the Fly, I had no idea they played anything before MK9.
Yeah, they were back before there was NRS tournaments, and we used to kind of do it competitively online, as competitive as you could online, because the netcodes were absolute trash. But MK9 was the starting of a new era, and of course you have like the MK3 era with Shock and CD Senior and all those guys. So then it goes back farther to them, and they were still around for MK9. And it was cool to see them kind of come to a resurgence and kind of have a little bit of success again in MK9. And that's the kind of exciting thing about Mortal Kombat, is every game that comes out, you kind of get to see that again, and it brings back some old names.
Yeah, I'm psyched to see a bunch of old names come back, especially the ones that didn't want to play Injustice or didn't play Injustice for long. But what was it? What was an NRS tournament? What was an NRS tournament like before MK9? Like, I can't even imagine. Like, I feel like every time I picture it, I just picture like four people around like a CRT playing the same game over and over again.
That's pretty much what it is, man. I think it was West Coast Warzone. Tom Brady would know about this in 2007 or 2008, where they had Mortal Kombat versus DC, and they had like four or five people there. I think it was like Crazy was there. I can't even remember. I just remember hearing about it on the forum because there was a while there where a lot of them switched over to Street Fighter because they wanted to get into the tournament scene, and there just wasn't that there for MK at that time. And in New York, I think they had a couple with Rio was there as well, with again like four or five people playing MKDC in like the back room of like what was then considered a major. It's definitely come a long way when you see
When you
that
see that
it got like 500 people at Evo for MK, which doesn't seem like a whole lot compared to the other games, but for NRS, that's absolutely huge.
Yeah, it's just crazy to think about just people coming this far and people coming together to play that shitty game. And I mean, just because they loved it.
It's passion, man. It's always been there. MK fans are crazy. We'll bring our setups and we'll sit in the corner and not bug the adults if you just let us play there and have a tournament,
Yeah. Oh man, I can't imagine.
What was the Halo community like, like contrast to the NRS community? I've heard mixed things about those kind of shooter type communities.
Well, see, the tournaments that I was talking about before, that was strictly just a local thing. It wasn't like on a scale of like MLG or anything. The place that I went to, it was called Reality's Edge, and it was mostly like a hobby shop. Like they had, I remember talking to the owner and seeing how he got how he got the setup that he has. So in the front of the store, it's like they have like magic cards and all these hobby things, Dungeons and Dragons stuff, and what's the other big one? Warhammer, I think people
Oh
are like
yeah.
about. So he had like an Xbox, and I think he had two Xboxes and a TV. And a lot of the people that were into, Dungeons and Dragons, Warhammer, these are pretty like classic things. And they were older, and they had kids. And if know a little bit about Dungeons and Dragons or Warhammer, or have even heard of it, you know that this isn't just like a 1 hour thing. This is like an all day agenda. And when you go and you're passionate about this and you have little kids, like your little kids aren't just gonna sit there. So the guy started setting up an area in his shop where he had Xboxes, and the kids would just sit there all day and play while their parents would play Warhammer and Dungeons and Dragons. So anyway, so he kept getting more Xboxes, and then we're talking about the original Xbox. This is we're talking about Halo 2. We're talking about 2004, and so he just started running Halo tournaments, and I can't even remember how I found out about it. I want to say like I Google searched Halo 2 tournament, New Jersey, and it came up. And I mean, we were all pretty close. We would like to like during the week we would go and play there. I mean, it was just kind of fun. No one was really that serious,
Yeah.
and I guess what you've heard about the Halo community, I guess you're probably hearing more about when it gets to like a top level, like we're talking about like MLG stuff, you know, all those big names. I'm assuming that you're referring to a lot of the stuff that Zyfox says on TYM.
I honestly don't pay attention to much stuff that Zyfox says. I don't really know a whole lot about like the Halo or the Call of Duty community, stuff like that. Like, I know that they can be, from what I hear, a little aggressive sometimes, but again, I don't know if that's true. I've never gone to try and find that out.
I mean, I think it's just the type of, I feel like I wouldn't see anything that I wouldn't see at a fighting game tournament. Like, not every, you know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's that different. I don't.
The hype levels are there. People are excited.
I don't know.
There's lots of,
yeah,
but there's some trash talk, but I'd imagine it's not too racy, but who knows?
No, but I mean, that you're going to get that when you play any game competitively. Like, that's just human nature, I guess. But if I remember any, I remember Zyfox saying something about how, okay, I remember what it was now. It was about how if you were not a known player or known person, that nobody wanted anything to do with you. And he was saying how, you know, fighting games and NRS community stuff, everyone's real open to hearing about everyone's opinion, which I don't think is always true.
Sounds not like far from the truth, but continue.
yeah, but I can see where he's going, where as in what I think it is that there's so many, well, when you're talking about a shooter, there's a bigger player base than the fighting game community. Like, the fighting game community is so small that you can't just turn someone away, or you can't just ignore someone or hate. You can hate someone, but like, you know what I mean? Like, they're always there. They're always going to be around. So because they're so familiar, it's, you know, why wouldn't I sit down and talk to this guy? Whereas Halo, if you're a top player, you have to like go through crowds of people to get to your event. There's crowds of people cheering for your game. And then that's just comparing Halo to the fighting game community as a whole. Now, if you're taking an even smaller part of the fighting game community, which is our NRS games, it's even that factor is there even more, where we're just small. We're small and we have to deal with each other, and there's no reason to really ignore someone or kind of just, you know, pass them by without acknowledgement.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And, you know, we're all kind of in this together, and right now we're kind of at a stage where we have to grow the FGC, and we need everyone to be able to do that. Like, if you think about Injustice, like, there was over, what, almost 3 years, the game being out, there was three Flash players that I remember making a splash, really, like Zyfox, Honeybee, and Herald. And they all kind of, you know, like, I remember Zyfox being, like, the first Flash player that was mentioned, and then Harold had, like, his top 8 at final round, and then after that, I don't know if they stopped playing or if they stopped traveling or what, but then kind of Honeybee was kind of took over. It's kind of neat to see that kind of progress that way.
What, the way Honeybee started coming around when they all stopped playing or when they stopped competing?
Pretty much. You know, like, they pass the torch, kind of. They're like, all right, here you go. Your turn.
Yeah, I can see that. But I feel like Honey, honestly, out of all of them, as much as I love Zyfox and Harold, I feel like Honeybee is just very, he puts in so much work into the game with setups, practicing his execution. It is absolutely amazing seeing how well he does online when it's really laggy, and he does this immense combo. And I'm just, the first thing I'm thinking, I'm like, how are you doing this with all this lag? This doesn't make any sense. Like, he definitely has like an online mode and an offline mode. And that blows my mind, because my combos, which are like probably 10 times easier than him, I drop all the time online.
Yeah, I'm the complete opposite. Like I am, because I don't have a scene to train with or anything. Like I'm the only one, within 5 hours that plays this game. So like I only have online. So when I go offline to my locals every month, I have to sit for like 2 or 3 hours and just regain how to play offline. So for someone like Honeybee to be able to just go back and forth so effortlessly, like that's a huge advantage because you're going to get a ridiculous amount of matchup knowledge online. I think it's probably one of the best training grounds out there, as long as you're able to adapt and go back and forth with your combo execution.
Well, see, here's the other big advantage he has is his brother is an amazing player as well, and they live in the same house and they get to play all the time. Do you know how much I would love to have a brother who played or and wanted to be good at the same game and just wanted to grind it out and just play over and over and over again? Like that would be amazing. And that's why I think Honeybee is such an amazing player. And Biohazard's great too, is that they get the matchup knowledge that they need to get from playing online, and they can easily just, I guess knock on the other brother's door like, "Hey, do you want to play right now?" And they'll just play for hours, like easily accessible and effortlessly.
Yeah, I'm extremely jealous of that. And even like if you're playing something online, something maybe you've never seen before, just go over and say, "Hey, you want to can you pick this character and just let me see if how I can help me see how I can punish this move," kind of deal. Stuff like
Yep.
that is like invaluable. I love
Yeah,
that.
that's great.
So I'm gonna get to the next question here. So I want to talk about Batman a little bit since you are known for playing the Dark Knight. What do you think is Batman's worst matchup, and what do you think is his most favorable matchup, and why?
I hate determining matchup numbers.
I don't even need a number. I just need a name.
Yeah.
Just give me a name. What, even for just Darth Arma. Like, what's Darth Arma's worst matchup?
No, that's any matchup that requires me to be patient. I get bodied by Sinestro. I feel like I have a pretty hard time against Raven as well. You just gotta be patient. You just gotta. I don't know. That's just not my. It's not a strong point of mine. But if I were to say which one, what's a bad matchup, I'd probably say Harley Quinn. And I don't know if it's just me being impatient or me just being very impressed by Saltface. It could be one of those two things, but I feel like Harley has a really good edge on Batman. He can't rely on zoning because gunshots start up so quickly. And her air to airs are absolutely amazing. Like, if you want to try to beat her air to air, you're going to have to go for a very risky early jump one, or you're going to go for a jump two, and she's just going to beat you in the air every time. She does great damage output, so she never really has to be. She doesn't really have to be. She can get aggressive on your wake up, and she thinks, or she can pretend to be aggressive on your wake up. And if you try to slide to get out of any pressure, she's going to destroy you for it. But for the most part, I kind of agree with Forever King on how he says that Batman's pretty balanced, where he doesn't really get dominated too hard by any character, and he also doesn't dominate too hard. But if I were to give Batman his worst matchup, it would probably be either Harley Quinn. I'd say it's Harley. And I was thinking maybe Aquaman, but I feel like this ma that matchup isn't explored as much.
Harley was probably the last character that I expected you to say. I had no idea that that matchup was that bad. That's
Well,
crazy.
she also has I forgot to mention, it was in my head, but I just didn't say it. She has like a block infinite against Batman, and I forget what the string is, but it's a string where she holds a gun. She holds her gun, and it's like a normal string where she shoots you, and it's a mid, and it puts you in so much block stun that it gives her enough time to jump and keep doing it. So she can jump in on you and keep doing it. So the only way to get out of it is by taking a risk. You could dash forward as she's jumping, like right before she's jumping, but you can never really punish her for going for this block string, but she can punish you for trying to get out of it.
Well, that's fair.
So yeah, it's pretty, I think I want to say Sonic Fox is the one that found it and told TYM about it, but I don't remember. But I remember me and Saltface talking about this when we played at Summer Jam.
Okay.
And I got bodied. I got fucking bodied hard.
Damn. That's the last character I would have expected. I was totally expecting you to just go hands down Aquaman. And I think it was I thought I saw a tournament where you played in where you had to fight like three people consecutively who counterpicked you with Aquaman. Was that you?
That was NEC. The first counterpicker was Rico. It was Rico. He knows how to play Aquaman. I feel like he started playing Aquaman a lot just to counter me at the break.
Makes sense.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's not like he never – like, I wasn't surprised when he picked Aquaman. I was surprised when he did not pick Aquaman against Sonic Fox. I thought he was just going to pick Aquaman. But I wasn't surprised that Rico did, but he did. And I don't know. I just lost. And then Clark Luthor, who is also Black Adam main, picked Aquaman. But fortunately for me, I beat him. And then I was eliminated by Slayer, who switched to Aquaman.
That's going to be disheartening when someone's just got, like, the beat Batman button.
I don't think it's that simple, though. Like, they were close. Like, I didn't lose to Rico or Slayer very bad. And when I was, you know, and this is a disclosure, casuals matter. Casuals matter so much. But before the tournament, I was playing Gross because we were because he wanted to, I guess, settle some kind of insecurities he had about the first of five I played with him online on a Pig of the Hut stream, where I 5-0'd him when he tried to play Green Lantern and Aquaman. So we played a lot casually. I mean, it was totally like he wasn't mad or anything. It was just totally like fun. I love playing casuals, and I really wanted to play him offline to see what the difference would be. It was closer, but I was still able to. I mean, it's casuals. Casuals matter so much. I can't emphasize on that enough. Casuals matter so much. But I had the edge over his Green Lantern and his Aquaman. And I feel like it's because most Batmen don't know how to just calm down and just keep zoning Aquaman. And you have to switch from zoning and counter zoning. And once you have him in a combo and you once you have him in a juggle and you can still reset him with the standing grapple reset, you just can't use jump in two. You have to use jump in three because he'll get hit and knocked off his feet. So his trait will be useless. So you know how normally you go for the standing grapple reset and then you walk back, call out trait, and it's a reset ambiguous jump in. Yep. You just use a jump in three because in this game, jumping threes knock the opponent off their feet.
Okay.
So you can still do it to Aquaman. And he's also got Trident Rush, which is kind of annoying. But if you just play your full screen game against Aquaman, I feel like Batman wins.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah, just don't. Aquaman has to come to you. You get more from Batarangs versus From the Deep, especially if he's going to risk a From the Deep if you have a bat out, because on a read you can jump forward and release bat, and you can hit him with a Batarang. You can try to combo him if he doesn't have trait, or you could just stay full screen and then he realizes that he's at a life deficit and he has to come to you. If you watch me play Rico, you'll see that in the matches where I was able to calm down and actually implement this, Rico realized that I have to go to him because I'm going to lose if I don't. But once Aquaman does get in that close range, it's a little more in his favor. So I feel like Batman wins full range and Aquaman wins up close.
Cool. That's good to know. I kind of just thought he would try to rush From the Deep, and that's basically all there is.
No, there's more to be explored. Like after this, just check out that video and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about.
Definitely, man. I'll go right to it. So what about his most favorable matchup? What is the easiest matchup? Like, if someone picks a character against you in a tournament, and you're like, yes, I like this matchup.
I feel like it's probably Superman. Other Batman mains will dispute this with me. I feel like it's Superman. Batman just has so many options to keep Superman at bay. Superman has to play very, very risky to get any kind of damage on Batman. Batman also has the great advantage of being one of the two characters that tucks when he jump, like does a tuck jump roll jump when he jumps forward or jumps back, like a Deathstroke. Okay, and when Superman has him in breath pressure, he can still, even in the corner, he can still jump, jump back or jump forward. I mean, obviously, every option has an answer to it. So Superman, if Superman knows that you're going to be doing that, he can answer to it. But I feel like it makes it harder for Superman to hold him down in the corner, as opposed to when Superman holds down any other character that doesn't have that tucking jump.
I know in the Northwest we had three Superman players and two Batman players. And all the Superman players were constantly talking about how Batman beat Superman and how the matchup was really tough. So it's kind of interesting to hear you say that, because, you know, I wasn't really sure at that time. It was probably about a year or so ago, and I wasn't quite sure if the matchup was that bad or if it seems to be pretty straightforward for Batman. He has a lot of advantages.
Yeah, I mean, were you talking about, were they saying this pre-patch or post-patch?
No, it wasn't that far. It was definitely post-patch, like probably last May-ish, something like that.
Okay, yeah. No, definitely. That's how we always felt about it. I mean, even like, I guess maybe that's why I always had a different idea about pre-patch Superman. I never felt... Even though KDZ beat me a lot, I would feel like I know why I lost and what I had to do to try to win or switch it up. But it could have been just a match, like one of the few matchups where Batman could actually do something. Like, I didn't know what it was like to not have options or to be completely shut down by Superman.
Yeah, fair enough. So what aspect of Batman's game do you think is the most overrated, and which do you think is the most underrated, and why? If anything.
Yeah. What's super overrated is, there's this thing in the corner. Have you ever seen when Mia Forever King, when we grapple someone in the corner and we do a neutral jump two and then jump in to either cross up or not cross up?
Yeah, I have no idea what's going on at that point.
Well, it's really strange. You would think that that it's just a definite, it either crosses up or doesn't cross up, but because this game doesn't have God, what's the term? I'm like blanking on the term, but it's the term where this exists in Capcom games, where when there's something to block, or I'm sorry, not Capcom games, but in Street Fighter, but when there's something active in your in a close proximity, I think it's proximity guard. But when there's something to block in your vicinity, in your character's vicinity, and you're holding back, it doesn't allow your character to walk backwards. It forces your character to stay there and go into a blocking animation. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know what you mean. Like, I remember, I haven't played Street Fighter a whole lot, but I found that frustrating when someone would throw like a projectile at me and I'm like 3/4 of the screen. I'm trying to walk back, but it just starts blocking. I'm like, oh, like move.
Well, see, the reason that mechanic is there is for cross-ups, or at least that's why I think it's there. But in Injustice, that doesn't exist. And I mean, I'm not really trying to like shit on NRS or saying that they should have put this in or what, you know, anything like that. This is their first back-to-block game, so these things are going to happen. But the reason why this is so important is because of if a character has a great walk speed, they can hold left or right, and it'll walk them to the side that's going to be the correct side to block a jump in, like a jump in normal attack, like Batman's jump in too. Like, for example, in the neutral game, when Batman is – wait, Batman – there's no point in Batman trying to jump into on Raven because her walk speed is so good that at any point, if she just keeps holding one direction, she will get to the – you know what I mean? Like, she'll get to the right direction to block. You know, so at one point, if she'll hold left, she'll keep walking left and it won't cross up. And this is if she's on player one side. And if she holds right at that same point, at the same jump in, same exact situation, if she holds right, she will walk under Batman and block it cross up. So there's no, like, there's no distinction between the two. There's no consequence for going left as opposed to going right and going right as opposed to the left. So back to what I was talking about in the corner, a very overrated mix-up that Batman has in the corner is his jump into his neutral jump two and then a jump forward two or three or one, because there's a lot of inconsistencies with this whole mix-up, because it's just a lot of characters can block it going left or right. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I kind of get what you're saying.
Yeah. Huh.
Interesting.
Did I just make this extremely hard for you to edit?
No. No, I get it. I get it. It's yeah. Great. I think it's okay. So I actually didn't know that. So I wonder if Martian is one of those ones.
Cause
I always get hit by that every single time. They just jump, and I'm like, well, I might as well just not block. So I'm gonna get hit by whatever's happening to me right now.
Yeah. No, I mean, you can take it to training room, and you know what the other strange thing is that this situation varies depending on what character he's doing it to and what stage and what corner he's doing it on. So some stages, yeah, isn't that like the strangest thing?
That's like I don't know how to feel about that.
Yeah, it's very, very strange. Like I was trying to compile data for this to figure out how to cross up, how to make a definite cross up and a definite not cross up situation for every character. And then the more I started compiling this data, the more I was finding inconsistencies. And I was like, why did this work on Lobo when I tried it a week ago to start this data, but how come it's not working now? And then I realized, I'm like, oh my God, this changes with every stage I go on. So then I started compiling data and taking notes on what stage I was on, and I was finding it, and then I was finding it consistent. So if I, for example, if I put Lobo in the corner on Ferris Aircraft, I can cross him up with a late jump in three, and I will not cross up if I do an early jump two. But if I do a later jump in two, he can block holding left or block holding right. And that's kind of the situation that you want to avoid. But once I realized that the stage mattered, I just gave up. I gave up on compiling all this data. I'm just like, this is so tedious. I can't do this. This is going to take forever.
Yeah, I mean, every single character on every single stage, that's like, is it worth it at that point? Like,
and it's every corner. Like, so some stages have four corners.
Oh yeah, with the two levels, like, yes. Oh man, I can't imagine.
Yeah, so that's why I was like, no, I'm done. This isn't happening. I have no, I can't. I guess it's the interactables. They do something to the game mechanic that changes it, because I found it very hard to see what was going on or to really get a good. To get something consistent in the corners that had interactables.
Right. I remember hearing something about that. I was trying to play Killer Frost for a little bit, and I think Ricky Ross told me that she has like a command grab infinite on Batman, but it only works on Atlantis in the corner.
Why?
I don't know. It's something to do with, like, when she does, like, the grab, how she kind of, like, lunges forward to do it. And mm-hmm. then, like, she goes back and then lunges forward. So, like, when she grabs him and she knocks him down and you do the command grab again, she crosses him up backwards and then lunges forwards and grabs him. And for some reason, his wake-up doesn't come out or something.
His wake-up might be get reversed, like when you try to wake up on Doomsday. Is that what happens?
I don't think it's reversed, because he said it was, like, a true infinite, and it was never patched, and he found it, like, before the big patch came out, and then he tried it after, and it apparently still worked. And I'm trying to understand why. I think it OTGs or something. It must, because apparently he can't wake up or anything. I could never get it, because apparently it's, like, a just frame, but I don't know.
I gotta see that, but we'll right now I'm skeptical. But I wouldn't be surprised.
In this game, anything's possible. I'd ask Sonic Fox about it. He knows a lot about Frost. He probably knows about it.
Possibly. That kid knows everything.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about MKX then. So how are you liking what you've seen of MKX? Have you had any, like, thoughts or anything about the game? Are you planning on playing it? I'm assuming you are.
Yeah, I definitely am. I tried for a very long time to not watch too much footage of MKX, as I'm just like, I'm just gonna get excited over a game that I cannot play, and it's gonna discourage me from playing Injustice. It's gonna discourage me from playing anything else, because all I want to play is MKX. And I was doing pretty good. I did a pretty good job until one day I was pretty bored, and, you know, I was texting my friend Steve-O, and he was like, oh, are you going to watch the MKX stream? It's about to come on. And I was like, yeah, I got nothing going on. I'll watch it. And that was the Reptile stream, where the Reptile versus Katana. And after that, I just went back and watched everything, all the trailers, all the streams, and now I can't stop thinking about it.
You were hooked. You got hooked. That's yeah. You took the bait.
I really wish I didn't. I mean, I was gonna buy the game anyway. Like, it didn't matter. They could shovel dog shit at me, and I was gonna buy the game.
Who knows? The freaking NRS, man.
That's true. It could be, but I mean, I'm gonna buy it. They're gonna get my $60. That's the point I'm trying to get across.
Anyone you're looking at maining so far yet, or were you hoping for a character that one of your favorites come back?
Not really hoping for anyone. I'm just kind of seeing what's gonna happen. I'm usually very anti girl character. I always play guy characters, but I think I would break the rule for Frost.
Yeah, she's classic.
I don't know. I like her concept when I was younger. I thought it was really cool. The female Sub-Zero and I don't know. I feel like it'd be like reliving like a little part of my childhood playing her again. But other than that, from everyone who's announced now, I think Quan Chi looks pretty good.
Oh yeah, he does, buddy.
Yeah, I think there's going to be some awesome standing reset potential there. I wonder if they're going to get rid of the mechanic in their engine that allows for like resets after like a whiffed normal. You know what I'm talking about? Like with basically what I do with the grapple reset, calling out trait counts as a whiffed normal. Like, imagining that if Quan Chi has an unreactable low or overhead after he puts them in the zombie trance, that he can I wonder if he can whiff something and reset and do like a standing reset. So basically you won't have to worry about any wake up attacks because they're standing already.
See, I don't think that mechanic was there in Mortal Kombat 9. I could be wrong, but I know for trance, like, if I whiff a normal and jump at you, I'm still going to hit you, and it's not going to reset anything.
Okay.
I think that was a new thing for Injustice. I'm not really sure why. But I know one thing that the Quan Chi players did used to do was you could get them in a trance, and then you do a jump and punch, and then you just delay, like, a second before the follow-up. and that will reset them.
Okay, so that's what you'd have to do in MK.
Yeah, so you do like a jump and punch, wait like a split second so that way it doesn't combo, and then you do the overhead or the low, and then that's their chance to block it. And then if they don't block it correctly, then you can get the reset.
All right, that sounds good.
So that's how things worked in MK9 a little bit. I think that's kind of the basis with how Cyrax worked, but I don't really know a whole lot about him other than he sucks. Well, not sucks, but sucks like you hate your life when you play him.
Only if you're as good as DJT.
Yeah, that's true. His Cyrax was crazy.
Yeah.
So that's basically all the questions I had. So you have any shout-outs or anything before we go, or any final words?
Not too much. Shout-outs to Ruthless Mayhem. Shout-outs to Stranger. Shout-outs to my boys, KDZ, Decay, Indecisive, Icy, and anyone else I'm not thinking of from the break. I can't wait to get back there in May, and I'm sorry, in April, and just grind out MKX with everyone. Oh, shout-outs to Gurr. I love Gurr.
Gurr, the Joker player.
Joker.
Joker, that's so brilliant.
Another terrible one. All right, that's it.
Oh, that's great. Well, it's been great having you on the show, and I appreciate you coming on, man. This has been a lot of fun.